algae is often considered a nuisance, growing in fish tanks or even worse, in swimming pools. But algae holds a lot of promise as a source of medicine, food, and fuel. In his book, Green Algae Strategy, ASU Professor Mark Edwards explores the potential benefits of algae. The book was recently selected by independent publishers as the top science book of 2009. In the book, Edwards takes a look at algae research, including some taking place right here at ASU.
My research career has been mostly spent looking for this opportunity to exploit the algae in a way that will solve some of our problems.
For the past two decades, the researchers have continued their search for new varieties of algae that are well suited to the production of fuels as well as other uses. These efforts have resulted in the creation of the Laboratory for Algae Research and Biotechnology at ASU's Polytechnic campus. Here, Sommerfeld and his colleagues also work on developing improved methods for growing algae in specialized tanks or bioreactors.
The effort now is trying to, in a sense, domesticate these algae so that we can grow them in engineered devices to produce high-density algal culture that we can harvest and that we can ultimately extract the oil from and process to make a variety of biofuels, including biodiesel, jet fuel, as well as gasoline.
Joining me now is the author of Green Algae Strategy, Professor Mark Edwards of the Morrison School of Management and Agribusiness at Arizona State University. Good to see you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Ted.
I know we're talking about ASU and algae as fuel. I want to get to that, but I want to start with the idea of algae as food. Where are we with this? Talk to us about it.
Algae is the oldest food on Earth. Humans have eaten algae since the beginning of humans, and anyone near a lake or ocean, all of our ancestors either ate algae directly, fed it to their animals, and many times used it as fertilizer as well.
Okay, to modern times, is the idea that I'm a little bit of research here is a terrible thing,
yes.
But the idea of processing this stuff into flour, is that the idea?
There are many ways. Many times we just harvest, this is seaweed, which is macroalgae. And this is a product that we sell 6 billion tons of this every year. So throughout Asia, especially China, throughout the Pacific Rim, algae is a very common part of the diet. And it's very healthy, high protein, great nutrients, wonderful vitamins.
So instead of corn, wheat, soybean, you can get algae to do the same thing?
Corn, wheat, soybean all evolved from algae. Green algae was the original plant on Earth. Green algae saved the planet by transforming our atmosphere from carbon dioxide to O2. And everything evolved from algae, all the plants.
Okay, let's get to how you harvest algae. I mean, algae, most folks think of something you don't really want to deal with. How do you plant and harvest algae without damaging water supplies?
Okay, I brought a little demo here. This is my little...
Hold it. Yeah, hold it right in front of you there. Yeah, there you go.
There we go.
There you go. Yeah, just hold it right there.
Okay, we've got... all right, so we have three inputs, carbon dioxide and nutrients. And nutrients, Ted, we get from wastewater. So we're recycling waste. And then, of course, we have solar energy. So what algae is truly is green solar energy. And Arizona is positioned to be the green solar capital of the world because we are blessed with the most solar energy of any state in the union. So this is green solar energy. All we're doing is capturing that solar energy in green plant bonds. It's stored and it's portable, and then we can harvest it as a fuel, as a food, and the highest value is for medicines.
So medicine as well, so food, fuel, and now medicine as well.
Medicine as well. In fact, many people take fish oil.
Right.
And they think it comes from fish. No, it doesn't come from fish. It comes from algae. Because where do you suppose fish get their fish oil? Fish get it from algae. So producers in Israel produce the algae, squeeze the oil, and that's where we get our omega-3s and our fish oil. It's straight from the algae, and it doesn't build up the mercury you get from fish.
Okay, so we're talking water-based farms here to grow. How big do these farms have to be? Where do they have to be? Can they be anywhere?
They can be anywhere, but ideally you take non-crop land, so you're not competing with food crops. You take wastewater, or we are blessed in Arizona with something I didn't know about before this research. We have the most brine water of any state in the Union. So under our deserts are oceans of brine water. And guess what happens when you bring salty water, brine water, through an algae pond? It cleans the water. So you've taken non-potable water and made it clean. In Israel, 87% of their municipal water is cleared by algae.
Okay. Let's talk about harvesting this stuff even more here.
Okay. Sorry. Sure.
How fast does it grow? How fast do you harvest it? And compare it to plants that we're more familiar with.
Okay. Think of an algae as a single-celled organism like this. It's just a million times smaller, of course. But what they do is they clump and they grow together. But so one single-celled algae cell can multiply itself a million times a day. That means as we grow the product in the growing system, the culture, this is the first free lunch, because it can double its whole biomass by 11 o'clock in the morning. That means we typically harvest about half the biomass every day. Then when you compare that to soy or corn, the numbers come out to 50 to 100 times more productive per acre per year.
All right. Let's move to fuel now, because I know ASU is very much involved in the fuel aspect. How much involved, by the way?
Oh, ASU is a world leader in food. Bruce Rittman's lab in biodesign, Kwang, and you saw the Milton Summerfield at the intro, their labs are both working in different models for biofuels. And actually, theirs is the highest value because they're going for jet fuel, which is the highest energy fuel. And with algae, because it grows so fast, you can harvest a tremendous amount of algae and recover the, and generally it's through extraction, pressing. But Bruce Rittman, Professor Rittman's work in their algae is actually secreting the oil. So it just floats to the top, they skim it off.
So we're talking diesel here as far as fuel is concerned.
We can talk diesel, we can talk gasoline, we can talk jet fuel.
Okay.
Depends on the length of your carbon chain.
Talk about emissions. Something's got to be burning there,
oh,
right?
Oh, great question. I love this question because algae burn clean. Algae is a vegetable oil, so it doesn't have any black soot particulates. Reason? It wasn't fossilized. All of our fossil fuels, if you look at the DNA, are algae from ancient oceans. So the algae was fossilized over 400 million years. And all we're doing here at ASU is we're taking the 400 million years and compressing it into about 4 weeks, and we can produce oil.
We got about 30 seconds left. That's the stuff that smells like French fries, isn't it?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, 30 seconds left. How soon before all of this becomes, a reality? I mean, more than just we're talking about it, but you're actually smelling French fries on the road outside.
We're producing it right now, and we'll be producing it to scale in the next 2 to 3 years. And scale means large, large scale. So it's a fabulous potential for food, for medicines, and Arizona can be the green solar capital of the world, because we have just exactly what's needed here.
All right. Well, it's fascinating stuff. Thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Pleasure.